Honors. May it please the Court, Counsel Allison Young for Appellate Mindy Amundson. This case presents two assignments of error. There was an issue with appropriate remedy, but we've withdrawn that. We believe the issue most ripe for adjudication was the one on which the District Court did not rule.
I'm sorry, which one is the one? What did you withdraw?
We withdrew an issue of remedies. In the pleadings, we had requested immediate payment of benefits. We've withdrawn that.
All right. You mean in your letter you say, yes, you agree it should go back?
Yes.
To the ALJ?
That's correct. Right. We believe the issue most ripe for adjudication is the ALJ's inclusion of skill level in the residual functional capacity. Skill level is, we believe this is impermissible because skill level does not usefully convey what the claimant is actually limited in. This was intended by the judge to address both migraine headaches and her mental health impairments from depression, and skill level just doesn't address that. In the Code of Federal Regulations, mental abilities assessed include the ability to understand, remember, and carry out instructions and respond appropriately to supervision, co-workers, and work pressures. A broad limitation to low semi-skilled work just doesn't address those factors. Skill level is addressed in the Code of Federal Regulations, but not until 20 CFR 404-1565, all the way at Step 5. Once it's been determined a person can't do their past work, then we look to skill level to see whether there are skills that can be transferred to other work.
Counsel, in your opinion, where did the ALJ incorporate the skill level analysis that you are telling us is erroneous?
Well, the judge put it in his RFC assessment. He said that the claimant, based on migraines and limitations to depression, would be limited to, and I quote, low semi-skilled work. It would have been appropriate had the judge reached Step 5 to look at skill level there. But this was the judge's interpretation of several different doctors who had indicated various limitations, generally converging around a limitation to simple routine tasks.
Harmless errors play into this determination. In other words, later on, right, when he got to the, I guess it was Step 5, more or less, doesn't the ALJ correct that? Correct that in the sense that the assumptions for the job indirectly address the RFC capacity, right?
It's possible that on remand that might be the result, Your Honor, but we believe the error...
We can't infer that now.
We can't infer that now because the limitation that essentially all of the doctors that assess mental health gave was some version of simple routine tasks. This court in Zavalin indicated that there was at least an apparent conflict between, on the one hand, the limitation of simple routine tasks, and on the other hand, a job like the job that the claimant had as her past work at Step 4, which required reasoning level 3. So there is a potential conflict there that the vocational expert was never given the opportunity to resolve. It's, I think, instructive to look to the agency's own interpretation of their rules, and this is, I realize that SSRs are not binding on this court, but they do reflect the agency's own interpretation. SSR 8241, when speaking about semi-skilled work, which is work with an SAB of 3 or 4, said the content of work activities in some semi-skilled jobs may be little more than unskilled. Therefore, close attention must be paid to the actual complexities of the job in dealing with data, people, or objects, and the judgments required to do the work. In Zavalin, this court said that reasoning level is an appropriate metric to assess that. What we're asking the court now to find is that skill level is not such an appropriate metric.
Counsel, just so I understand your argument, do you disagree that the ALJ accounted for all of the claimant's mental and physical impairments in making its RFC determination?
We do disagree with that. We feel that the only thing addressing the migraines or the depression was this limitation of skill level, which is just insufficient to explain what the claimant was or was not capable of doing.
Okay, but would you agree that at least the ALJ articulated all of the mental and physical impairments that he was considering?
Well, yes, he did articulate all of the impairments in Step 2. The question is whether the RFC adequately addressed those impairments. So we do feel that skill level does come into play at Step 5, but the judge didn't reach Step 5. So skill level just had no place in the four corners of the decision that's before you.
All right, perhaps we should hear from the government, and that would help us determine where the difference is between your arguments. We'll
that
give
sounds
you,
great.
Okay. We'll give
I've
you
got 5 minutes. Awesome.
Yes, you do. Thank you.
May it please the court, counsel, Lars Nelson on behalf of the Commissioner of Social Security. This court should affirm the decision of the administrative law judge and the commissioner in this matter because the decision is supported by substantial evidence and free from prejudicial legal error.
Well, do you agree, though, in his five-step analysis, the ALJ did not really make a correct RFC finding?
No, I would disagree with that, Your Honor. Skill level, whether it's unskilled or semi-skilled, has a specific definition. And that definition includes, at the unskilled level, a restriction to simple work duties. And at the semi-skilled level, it is effectively simple duties plus. It's not complex duties, but it's more than just simple duties. So when the ALJ restricted the claimant to low semi-skilled work with the SVP of 3, the specific vocational preparation of 3, the ALJ was in fact incorporating that definition of work that is simple but not complex, but not just simple. There is something more.
But doesn't the ALJ normally go into more of an explanation as to what the remaining functional limitations are before proceeding to determine what jobs can be performed? I mean, like ability to lift so many pounds, ability to work so many hours in a work day, ability to interact with the public. Generally, that's what we see when we look at the assessment of the residual functional capacities. Would you agree with that?
Well, I would, Your Honor. And the residual functional capacity in this matter includes a restriction to light work and other postural limitations. It's just the main point of Ms. Amundson's argument before this court is that the mental impairments were not accounted for.
Well, no, her argument is that skipping to saying semi-skilled or the skilled level leaves out a step in terms of assessing the residual function of the claimant and doesn't tell us exactly what the ALJ determined the disabilities were. That's how I understood her argument. Do you see her arguments being something different than that?
No, Your Honor, but I think the argument as to using the term semi-skilled is only related to her mental impairments. The argument of whether she can do light work would be related to her challenge to Dr. Leeson.
So your understanding of opposing counsel's argument is that her disagreement with the ALJ's determination only relates to the mental capacity or the mental remaining mental abilities.
Of her two issues, the second issue is just as you described.
Okay.
The ALJ in this,
But let me ask you this. What does semi-skilled mean in terms of residual functional capacity? What does that mean to you?
According to 20 CFR 404-1568, which defines unskilled work and semi-skilled, unskilled is a restriction to simple duties, whereas semi-skilled work reflects the ability to perform not only simple duties, but something more, but less than complex.
How does that correlate to the mental impairments that were reflected in this claimant's history? How does that translate?
Well, the ALJ had Dr. Cole, who was able to translate those impairments. And Dr. Cole said that she was able to sustain simple routine duties. And that would, I would say, would be consistent with unskilled work. And had Dr. Cole just stopped there, then the RFC probably should have been simple routine duties. But Dr. Cole went further and said not only can she sustain simple and routine duties, but she has a mild impairment in simple multi-step tasks. Now, the ALJ was, when Dr. Cole said this, the ALJ was presented with a problem, because mild cannot easily translate into functional limitations in the residual functional capacity assessment. The ALJ can't present the term mild to the vocational expert. So the ALJ used the language provided by the vocational expert to describe the past relevant work to articulate what something beyond simple and routine but short of complex was. And the best term that the ALJ had accessible to him was semi-skilled work. Now, it would be the position of the commissioner that that's enough. Semi-skilled has a definition, and we can reasonably see that by looking at that definition that there, the ALJ accounted for the ability to do simple duties and something more short of complex. But this is a step four case, a past relevant work case, and therefore it's Ms. Amundson's burden to show she cannot perform her past relevant work. And here she hasn't shown that Dr. Cole's opinion, if the residual functional capacity assessment should be reflected specifically as Dr. Cole described, ability to sustain simple routine work plus the ability to do with a mild limitation, simple multi-step tasks. She hasn't shown that that conflicts with the GED reasoning level of 3, and she hasn't shown that that conflicts with the mental demands of her past relevant work. And that would be the harmless error analysis that this court should perform, and she frankly hasn't made that showing here. The argument is two steps. One, she has to show error in assessing the residual functional capacity assessment, and two, she has to show that that error was consequential, that is, she couldn't perform her past relevant work.
But your position is there was no error.
That's correct, Your Honor.
Your fallback position that if there was error, any error was harmless?
That's correct, Your Honor. And DLJ, in interpreting Dr. Cole's opinion, that is consistent with Stubbs-Danielson, where in that case the ALJ had to determine what is a moderate limitation in concentration, persistence, and pace. And again, moderate is not a useful vocational limitation, and therefore the ALJ translated that into simple and routine tasks.
But at least it speaks in terms of the terminology that's normally used in terms of persistence and pace and the vernacular that's normally referred to when determining, you know, whether the past relevant work can be performed. This was very truncated in terms of interpreting the doctor's comments.
I would disagree with saying that it's truncated, because the ALJ did ultimately use the exact language used by the vocational expert. And I would say in translating Dr. Cole's opinion, the ALJ also benefited from knowing that the claimant exercised on a regular basis. And she was doing kickboxing. And going to a kickboxing class, you're obviously going to be presented with instructions all throughout the class that you're expected to follow. The ALJ also noted that she was caring for her grandchildren, which obviously includes the ability to do something more than just strictly simple work, watching multiple grandchildren. And during the relevant period, she called herself a real estate investor. And the ALJ had these additional facts that the ALJ had to account for when interpreting Dr. Cole's opinion. And it's the position of the commissioner that the ALJ reasonably did so here, and because the ALJ's interpretation and residual functional capacity assessment is consistent with the vocational testimony in this matter, that there is no error in this case, and because appellant hasn't shown any conflict between Dr. Cole's opinion as specifically articulated and her past relevant work, she can't show prejudicial error. And therefore, the commission would ask the court to affirm.
Thank you, counsel. Rebuttal?
In In terms of a conflict, we believe that Zavalin actually gives us exactly the conflict that we would be looking for here. Dr. Cole's opinion was indeed that the appellate was limited to simple routine tasks and had only mild problems with simple multi-step tasks. That still confines her to essentially simple tasks. Dr. Paul Rethinger for the state agency interpreted that to say that she was limited to short, simple routine instructions in a normal work day.
What about the observation that she could take multi-task steps? What do you do with that language?
I think a multi-step task is still consistent with reasoning level 2, Your Honor. It's potentially not consistent with reasoning level 3, which requires applying common sense understanding to carry out instructions furnished in written, oral, or diagrammatic form, dealing with problems involving several concrete variables in from standardized situations.
In your view, what specific finding should the ALJ have made that he did not make?
Well, I believe that the medical opinions converge around a limitation to simple routine tasks. That's not the only option before the judge. He could have literally used the language from Dr. Cole that she was capable of simple routine tasks and simple multi-step tasks. He could have presented that to the vocational expert. Had he done so, we might be left with the same ultimate outcome, but we would have at least a proper finding.
So your basic disagreement is with the question that was posed to the vocational expert.
Exactly right, Your Honor. Given that the judge presented the vocational expert and said, well, she can do low semi-skilled work. Can she do her past work, which happens to be low semi-skilled? That's taking the discretion completely away from the vocational expert. The vocational expert wasn't presented with what she can or can't do. He was told she could do work with this skill level and then asked if she could do work with that skill level. The answer is obviously yes. It's a leading question. Indeed, semi-skilled work involves some skills, and as written, the judge's RFC indicates that she could do the entire universe of SVP3 work, which is on its face ludicrous. There are lots of skills involved in the various jobs that are SVP3. They may not be particularly involved. Obviously, they take some time to learn, but the RFC implies that the appellant has already learned all of them. I would also submit that while there is some rough correlation between the complexity of the job and its skill level, that correlation is incidental and inconsistent. As we briefed, there are jobs with an SVP of 4 that are nonetheless reasoning level 2. There are also unskilled jobs with an SVP of 2 that have a reasoning level 3. So there is some correlation, but it's lumpy. There would also be a correlation between the complexity of a job and the rate that you can get paid for doing that job. It does not follow that a judge could say a claimant was limited to minimum wage work. The question here, of course, is whether the claimant can do her past work, not necessarily all work, because the judge found that she was capable of that at step 4. But again, I would note that the vocational expert was presented with the answer to the question and then simply had the opportunity to say yes or no. The RFC told them that he could. Didn't tell him what he could do.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I'm fine. Go ahead.
So Dr. Cole said that the claimant was able to sustain simple routine tasks with only mild problems completing a simple multi-step task. You say that adding that last phrase doesn't change the fact that she was limited to simple routine tasks.
It might. It might not. I don't know. That was never presented to the vocational expert, and that's where I think the harm is here.
Okay, we understand your argument.
All right, thank you, Your Honor.
All right, thank you to both counsel. The case just argued is submitted for decision by the court. The next case on calendar for argument is United States versus Harder.